There we go. YouTube says we're live. That's good news. You've arrived at the Silent Comedy Watch Party. It is October 11th, 2020. We are live just on the other side of the screen from you, wherever you are. It is October 11th, 2020. This is our 29th episode, our 7th month of doing this here every week, helping you get through whatever you're getting through. I'm Ben Modell, one of your hosts, along with Steve Massa, who will bring out in a moment. But we just wanted to go live a few minutes early so you know you've come to the right place.
Yes, happy Sunday, everybody. If you're on the East Coast where we are, you still have about 5 minutes to microwave some popcorn before the show starts. If you're on the West Coast, maybe making a little lunch or a snack, and our friends in Europe and Scandinavia, maybe a nightcap or a cup of hot cocoa. And if you're in other parts of the world, perhaps you're eating breakfast with us. Anyway, welcome.
Thank you, Mana, and thanks for all of you watching from wherever you are. Here's a few minutes of music while you wait. Yes, going in and out of time. always fun to play with time signatures when I can and it doesn't distract from a movie. You have arrived at the Silent Comedy Watch Party, episode 29. We have not begun the show yet, but we have begun streaming. We are 100% live streaming to you from New York, from my living room, our living room, and Steve's, Steve Massa and his wife Susan's living room.
Across town.
To yours. Your media room, your car, wherever it is you're watching us from, we're so glad you could join us. We'll be starting in a couple of minutes. But just want you to know you've come to the right place and you can set your audio levels before we get going. Start in a few minutes. Thanks. Thank you. Yes, hi. Good to see you.
Happy Sunday.
Oh, thank you, Mona. Thanks for getting the lights. That's my wife, Mona Allen, operating the lights, panning us back and forth. Thank you so much, Mona. This is the Silent Comedy Watch Party. Greetings across whatever you watch stuff on. I'm Ben Modell. Hello. Good to see you again. I'm a silent film accompanist and historian. If you're not so sure, there it is right there. And we're here streaming classic comedy shorts to you every week since the second week of March. Believe it or not, I'll be bringing out my co-host Steve Massa in just a moment. But we wanted to greet you and welcome you. Thanks for having us into your living rooms and your in hours here, streaming virtually all over the world. We hear from so many people in different parts of the planet, and we're so glad to hear from all of you. This is episode 29. We are streaming to you live. It's October 11th, 2020, and it's 3 o'clock here. I don't know where it is, what time it is where you are, but we're so glad we could visit with you and you with us. We've got a great program for you today. We have a one-reeler and a three-reeler, and we'll get into
that. That's the first time we've done a three-reeler.
Yeah, we haven't had a three-reeler before, but Harold Lloyd made a lot of them, quite a number of them. So we didn't want to go over putting too much film in, but in order to accommodate this short, this is how we're doing today's show. Anyway, we're flexible. It's a great film. It's fun, one that doesn't get shown. It's not one of the hit. It's not on the hit parade, but it's a great short just the same. We want to thank. We mainly want to thank you for watching, for telling your friends, sharing links, and sending in messages by email or comments on social. It means a lot, and it's fun for us to hear from you. So if you feel like, oh, he's really busy, or I don't want to bother him, it's fun to hear.
Busy.
Yeah, we're not. Yeah, it's always fun to hear from different people in different parts of the planet or parts of the U.S. or the different ways you're watching. I know that there are two people who watch almost every week from either end of Canada who text each other, and there are people. I know there's a few younger people who watch this and connect over a Discord server, and their families and kids, and we love to hear from you. So, maybe post a comment on the YouTube link for this show, and we'll respond.
And Steve and
I
always say,
where are you watching? And Mana always talks about popcorn and different things and snacks. I know there are people watching in Buenos Aires and Argentina and Switzerland. So we'd love to know what your snack of choice is. I know there's somebody, one of our fans in Canada, every week there's a picture of her laptop and what she's eating before we start. So
and it looks delicious.
It's always, it's a lot of fun for us. So feel free to do that. I want to thank anybody who has sent in a contribution. We are set up to take payments online via all the different ways you can do that, as well as the little rectangular pieces of paper with writing on it. It's not why we're doing this, but if you are so inclined and so motivated, it's much appreciated. So we want to thank you for anybody who's been able to toss a couple of bucks in our tambourine. We want to thank everybody who works on these shows every week. My wife, Mona Allen, behind the camera.
My pleasure.
And reminding me why we're doing this and keeping me going. every once in a while, oh, it's so much work. There's so many people waiting for the show.
We've got to keep the laughs coming when
and,
we can.
Yeah, exactly. And want to thank Steve's wife, Susan, who watches the show in their apartment and texts Mona. We don't have a walkie-talkie or headset system, so she texts Mona if I go out as singer and we get things fixed up. So thank you to Susan. Thank you to, I'll just bring this up because, boy, we just love this graphic. Thank you to Marlene Weissman, our graphic designer, who does all of our graphics and is a brilliant graphic artist in her own right. So thank you to Marlene. And also thank you to Crystal Kai out in Pennsylvania, who pretty much keeps me on task, on target, and keeps a lot of stuff going. getting stuff posted up to the web and everything like that. So thank you, Crystal.
Yay.
And so with that out of the way, let's just bring on Steve. And what I'm going to do this time, because you know when we wave, I put him in the split screen, we lose his hand. So here's Steve. Hey, say hi to everybody, Steve.
Yay.
Oh, there you go. Oh, okay. A double salute.
Hi,
there you go.
Hey.
Hi. Good to see you, Steve. Everybody healthy over your place?
Yeah. Knock wood.
Yeah.
You
know, yeah.
Doing fine, hanging in there.
Yeah. Great. Great. Same here. So we've got a great show for everybody today. And why don't you tell everybody what we have teed up for our opening one reeler?
Okay. Well, what's we have teed up first is Outbound, and this is a 1924 cameo comedy, which was producer Jack White's one reel series.
Oops. Sorry, I started the film by mistake.
Oh, that's
I,
all right.
This is what I want.
Is that a hint?
No, that was like no. My button, the button for your credits, just next to it. Sorry about that.
That's all right. No.
Yeah.
So this was producer Jack White's one reel series of comedies. He started in 1922 and did through 1929, through you know the whole decade of the 20s, and it stars Sid Smith. It also stars there's Sid. In one of the Hallroom Boys comedies, on the to his left, the other guy being held is Harry McCoy, and then the guy all the way to the right, pointing with the glasses, is a character actor named Joseph Baldy Belmont, and he was bald. But if he shows up early in the film in a toupee, you know he's going to lose it at some point. Because he always that was like a shtick that they always did with him. He'd lose his toupee. Or, you know, his fiancée would find out he had a toupee or something during the picture and be aghast. But Sid Smith, he was one of those comics. There were many little comics with a mustache. And these guys were like, you know, as prolific as weeds in silent comedy. There was Sid Smith. And here's Sid again in another Hallroom Boys comedy. That's Jimmy Adams in the other top hat next to him on the bench. And the cop is Baldy Belmont again. And this park is the park Chaplin uses in the Idol Class.
Oh, yeah.
He's sitting on the bench next to the guy, and there's somebody behind him who's picking the guy's pocket, and it looks like it's coming from Charlie.
Yeah.
But that's the same park. And then the dog is Seven Boy.
That's the name of the dog, for those of you playing along at home.
He belonged to, like, production manager, a guy named Jack Mintz, who worked on these films, and that was Mintz's dog, Seven Boy. And he turns up in a lot of the comics.
Yeah, but and Jimmy Adams is another one of those little guys with a little mustache. We've shown in our Mostly Lost program, we ran a Jimmy Adams comedy, and he showed up with his little thin mustache as well.
Jimmy Adams, Monty Banks, Neely Edwards, Al, the list goes on.
Yeah.
There were just tons of these little guys. And Sid Smith was very funny. You know, he was a very able comedian. He was very good at doing the physical action. You know, he doesn't have a sort of a deep character like Keaton or Chaplin, but he was a very, very able slapstick practitioner, you know, and he has a lot of charm. He's a lot of fun. Also, his co-stars in the film are Cliff Bowes, who we've shown a few times. And Virginia Vance is the leading lady. And Cliff Bowes and Virginia Vance were the original leading man and lady in the cameos. And at one point, they just brought Sid Smith in and sort of shoehorned him in with them. And then Sid left, and they stayed. But Sid's there for a while. And this is just a great example of what you would refer to as a gag comedy. Because there's not a lot of plot logic. It just moves from gag to gag to gag. But they're really great gags. I mean, Ben and I were talking while we were getting ready to do the show. It's like there's two reels worth of gags that sort of crammed in this one reeler. But they're all really good gags.
Yeah, and not only gags, but like all the gag sequences you might have that would take up more time in a two reeler, it's just like they crammed that many, and it's just goes from one thing. And
there's really no setup in between. They just go from gag to gag.
Yeah, and it was this thing, you know, this is something that Steve and I talked about, Eileen Bowser, who passed earlier this year, but who we got to know and who was the head of the archive at MoMA, who was a big fan of silent comedy, often said that, you know, you didn't have time to explain what was going on in terms of depth. You had to get to the next joke and then the next gag. And so the great thing about silent comedy is there's something about this world, because it's sped up and it's silent and it's black and white, they will buy it. And as long as everybody on screen buys it, we can go from this and you'll go in three sequences in and you'll think, how did we get here? Oh my God, this is happening. And then you forget about it. And it's really
like
well crafted. Yes.
You know, it just has that sort of dream logic where there is no logic often. And you just go with it and they just keep it moving. So, you know, you're just taken along.
Yeah. And at a time when a lot of main comedians, would move into the two reel format, the one reel format was still useful because there were dramatic features that were being released that were longer and longer. And if you were a theater owner and wanted to squeeze in more shows, a one reel comedy would be a great thing to just get the show going or save the show if you had a stinker that week.
And I think in the 1930s and 40s, the animated cartoons took the place of the live action one reelers. That's where all the gags and the crazy, you know, Bugs Bunny and, you know, were in the cartoons that fit in the program. So.
Yeah. So let's move on and see Outbound. This is a film that comes to us courtesy of Lobster Films and the Black Hawk Films Collection. This is something that was part of David Shepard's collection, and it was originally issued on the old Slapstick Encyclopedia set. So we're grateful to Serge Bromberg for giving us the thumbs up and the okay. And thank you, Mana. Mana caught that I had forgotten to shut off the split screen. Sorry, I'm a little scattered today, but I'm so darn excited about the program. Let's just call it that. Without any further ado, Mon, will you get the lights, please?
Do we have an archive to thank?
Lobster and Blackhawk. And you'll see their logo at the start of this.
Merci, Serge.
Thank you. And here is, from 1924, Outbound with Sid Smith and Cliff Bowes. Thank you. Wasn't that just the craziest thing? You know, there isn't a moment of, oh, I think we might have done everything we can do with this sequence. It's just, it's you get about three gags in. Oh, send him out the window.
Yeah. Let's find some alligators.
Oh, right, of course. Yeah, we're talking about this before. Like, oh, sure, there's alligators. Well, of course, because how do we get this guy out of the puddle?
There's alligators in mud puddles, you know. It makes no sense.
You got to look out for those puddles.
Yeah, it's great.
It's really just almost a non sequitur. It's like, how do we move these people into another space? I mean, because it starts off like, oh, poor Sid Smith, he can't pay the rent, and then
but
it's a lot of excitement. Yeah,
I do. I'm very fond of the gag where he puts on all his clothing.
Oh, yeah.
And then he walks out. He's completely bow-legged because of the pants. And, I mean, it's just such a funny little gag, a little throwaway.
And he's definitely not the first person to ever have done that, I'm sure.
No.
But it's a fun, and it's a fun short. And I noticed the director's name, Harry Edwards, at the top of the film.
We showed Harry Edwards, was it last week? And remember when, the Harry
He directed that
short.
As well, yeah.
He directed that. Yeah, he started as a prop boy at Universal, or a prop man at Universal, like in the teens. And then he started directing at LKO. And then he worked all over the place. And then eventually ended up at Max Sennett in the mid-20s. And that's where he hooked up with Harry Langdon and became Langdon's director of choice for, you know, for quite a while.
But his chops are definitely on display and in full force in this. It's a really tight, really frenetic, really great.
He just moves along.
Yeah.
And then you can see, really, this is Sid Smith's strength, is just moving. But he can really do these stunts. You know, he takes a lot of falls, and he's just... But he has, you know, he has a very kind of breezy personality, too. And it's not deep, but it's, you know, it's pleasant, it's breezy.
Yeah, and Cliff is a nice contrast because when they cut to him, he's doing these things on the bicycle where it's a little bit more centered to go back and forth. Yeah,
some nice bicycle gags too.
Well,
Sid Smith, you know, he's interesting because he worked for some of the biggest producers in the comedy business during the 1920s. He worked at Max Sennett, he worked at Fox, he worked for Al Christie, but at the same time, he worked for some of the most low-budget producers. Mm. He worked for this Tenek Films, Bullseye, and the worst was this William Pizor Productions, which are just, you know, the rock bottom, just no budgets, no gags, no supporting people. You know, you don't know who any of the people are. It's just Sid and someone, and he's the only name that they ever really used. But all through the 20s, he moves around. He goes to all these different studios, and he'll be at a rock bottom. Then he goes to Senate. Then he'll go to another low budget. But then he goes to Christie. It's you know, he just moved around all the time.
Yeah.
He spent the longest part of his career doing the Hall Room Boys comedies. And those were produced by Harry and Jack Cohen. Harry Cohen, you know, their company CBC became Columbia Pictures. So he was, you know, he was the big head of Columbia Pictures for many years. And he's infamous, you know, famous and infamous at Columbia. But Sid spent a lot of time there. He worked with a lot of different co-stars in the Hall Room Boys comedies. And he passed away in 1928. He was working for Al Christie. And he and Jimmy Adams were great pals, and they went out for Fourth of July celebration and ended up drinking some bad bootleg hooch, and Sid died.
Yeah.
And Jimmy was sick. He was off the screen for more than a year. He didn't return to the screen till 1930. So, you know, it's kind of a... And Al Christie paid for the funeral.
Yeah.
So,
Sid worked. What impresses me is like how much Sid worked. He just worked and worked and worked and worked
constantly.
Everywhere.
Constantly. Yeah. And he worked so everywhere.
So if you see a Sid Smith comedy, you don't know which studio it is by the fact that he's in it, because it could be any place.
It could be anywhere. And yeah. again, he worked at big plays. You know, he did a lot for Fox and he did for Senate. He started around 1915 in things, films for Pathé and Selig. He was at Selig for quite a while in their Bloom Center comedies, which were sort of a ripoff of SNA Snakeville comedies. And then he kind of moved up, but he worked all over and he worked constantly.
Yeah.
And we mentioned Harry Edwards because he was a real seasoned veteran. Cliff Bowes, you know, he worked at Senate. He spent time at Senate. And then he ended up being, you know, the cameo comedy's mainstay. He did a lot of cameos, even left for a while and then came back at the end of the 20s. And he had been a champion diver before he got into pictures. Mm-hmm. And the leading lady is Virginia Vance. And she started in cameos in 1922. The first star of cameos was Jimmy Adams with Virginia Vance. And then she finally was in two-reelers, a lot of two-reelers that were directed by Roscoe Arbuckle with Lupino Lane and Lloyd Hamilton. And then she went to Senate, but then she retired. She married the actor Bryant Washburn and retired from the screen. And her father is played by Bobby Burns. And
I heard it. Yeah, I've heard of him from Burns and Stahl.
Burns and Stahl, Pokes and Jabs.
Yeah.
So he was part of the team Pokes and Jabs who made pictures for Vim and Jackson and the teens. But he came from the stage. He was in the Broadway production of The Wizard of Oz. And he played the spider. Or I'm sorry, not Wizard of Oz, Babes in Toyland. Babes in Toyland. But he actually was in The Wizard of Oz later. But he was in Babes in Toyland, and the big climax had a spider, and he played the spider in a in a costume. And we have photos of him at the New York Public Library with his costume, like standing next to his costume, and he's in tights. But it, you know, and then in the costume. But he had a long stage career, and he started appearing in pictures around 1911 for Lubin. And by the mid-teens, he was teamed with this guy, Walter Stahl, and they did a number of these Pokes and Jabs comedies. Sometimes it's hard to tell who's Pokes and who's Jabs, because the comedies move so quickly. And then after that, he's all over the place. He did a series for Cuckoo Comedies. He made a lot of comedies in Florida for a while. Then he hit California, and then he's became a supporting comic. But like in this, but he was also a gag man. So he was writing gags as well as, you know, playing character roles. And in the sound era, he does that at Hal Roach. He turns up in a lot of the Laurel and Hardy films and also Columbia with the Three Stooges. He'll turn up and he was writing gags. So he had a long career. Eventually he was an extra. I was watching the movie A Tree Grows in Brooklyn from 1945. And he's in the library reading a book. So he had a long career. He worked a lot.
That's great. And speaking of Pokes and Jabs, we believe it or not, there's quite a number of the Pokes and Jabs comedies that do survive, and we will be including one of them on our program. That's our Halloween themed program in 2 weeks from today. But I do want to mention
very rare example of
But speaking of shows that are coming up, I wanted to let you know about our show next week, which is a special episode. We've shown a number of a couple of Harold Lloyd comedies that have little breakout sequences with Ernie Morrison, who is also known as Sunshine Sammy. And next week we will be doing a program where we will present two Our Gang comedies from the silent film era that feature Ernie Morrison, because the series was built around him. And we will also be welcoming as our guest Ina Archer, who's a filmmaker, artist, and a media conservator, and she's
in
a historian. And she, Ina, is somebody I met at an orphan film symposium screening at MoMA a year or two ago. And Ina and I have been in contact about having her on for this show. And she also works as a media conservator at the Smithsonian's National Museum of African American History and Culture. So we're lucky, and we're so thrilled to showcase work. It features Ernie Morrison. Yes, Mona.
Ina actually curated.
Yeah, Ina actually helped. Yeah, we knew we wanted to show a film called, well, one of the earliest surviving films with Ernie is part of Our Gang, but she helped us pick the films as well. So,
yay.
So we're definitely tune in. And speaking of Ernie Morrison, his father is in our next film. So why don't you talk a little bit, Steve, about what we've got set up, threaded up for everybody now.
Sure. Well, our next film is Now or Never. This is a 1921 Harold Lloyd three-reeler. So it's unusual. Harold, you know, he had jumped to two-reelers. He started his glasses character and became so famous in one-reelers and became so popular that they eventually moved to two-reelers, and those did so well that he and Roach ended up doing three, because they had so much good material, they ended up doing three-reelers, which is kind of an unusual, form in silent comedy. Usually it's one reels, or it's two reels, or it's a feature. But Harold did very well with the three-reelers. He actually made four of them, and this was the very first three-reeler that he made. There's another one. The one that followed was called Among Those Present. He did another one called I Do, but they weren't happy with it, and they ended up cutting a reel and then released it as a two-reel. The last three-reeler that Harold did was Never Weaken, which is probably the most famous, where he's on the girders. And the next film he made, A Sailor Made Man, was supposed to be a three-reeler, but they found they had so much great material, they just kept shooting, and that became Harold's first feature. Ben mentioned that Ernie Morrison Sr. is in the cast. You'll spot him as a porter on the train. And it has, you know, again, the regular Harold Lloyd, Hal Roach stock company. Mildred Davis is the leading lady. You'll see Noah Young, Mark Jones, William Gillespie, Sammy Brooks, little Sammy Brooks. So it's got, the regular group. And there are some other people that I do want to talk about, but I think we should take a look at the film first.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, Steve. Yeah, thanks. It's a fun short, and one of the things in going through the Lloyd two-reelers to choose them for screening them, as I would go through the filmography, what I noticed was interesting is that, yes, he made four three-reelers, but he didn't, when he moved out of one reels, it was either two or three, but it wasn't like an anomaly that he would do something this long. And the films that are three reels, usually what I noticed is that he'll spend more time in the first reel setting up and grounding the story the way the first third of Safety Last completely legitimizes and grounds the building climb. So it wasn't like, oh, we have three reels worth of, it wasn't just that there was three reels worth of gags, but I think because Chaplin, because he makes the kid and releases at the beginning of 21, I'm sure Lloyd must have seen, oh, we can go a little deeper. And yeah. as you'll see in Now or Never, we don't just say, oh, here's this, and then he's off and running.
Yeah, I think it's a real preparation for the move to features. You know, they started really kind of laying the groundwork for the characters and the story at the very beginning.
Yeah, so
which you
wouldn't
necessarily in a two-reeler. So I think it's a natural progression.
Yeah, which is probably why Keaton took longer to make the move, because he was, he was just making the two-reelers, but Lloyd was pretty much ready to go when he makes Grandma's Boy. So this is a fun short. This has been released on DVD in the late 2000s through New Line, but executive produced by Suzanne Lloyd, who we've had on our show, and thank you so much.
Thank you, Suzanne.
And thank you, Harold, for preserving these films and hanging on to good copies of all of these films. Just so you know, some of the things you'll see in this film is before we all flew, how many people fly anywhere right now, but before air travel became very common and popular, the way you got from one place to another that was a long trip, you took a train and you slept on the train. And so if you've seen Some Like It Hot, you may have seen evidence of this, but people would take a train trip and expect to sleep on the train. And these little cars that had curtains, and they were called, it was a Pullman car, and you had to figure which berth
was yours.
B-E-R-T-H. And there are all these different things where people are sleeping on it, and there's just different kinds of hazards, getting a drink of water. If you're in one of the cars where the windows were open and the train goes through a tunnel, you get soot from the engine all over your clothes and everything. You have to dealing with other passengers, and there's a common washroom that people, there are often sequences in films like this where men are trying to shave, because you wouldn't necessarily go to the ladies' room in a movie. So, but there's always the three or four people battling for space in a washroom. So there's all these different things. So these are interesting ways of seeing how people traveled and lived, 100 years ago. So we'll talk a little bit more after the film, but Manu, you'll get the lights.
I'd love to.
Thank you very much. Let's turn back our clocks about 100 years and enjoy Harold Lloyd in Now or Never. Here we go. Thank you. Yes, yes. Thanks for getting the lights. Thank you. Thank you. Ah, lots and lots of fun, lots and lots of action, at least in the last half of the third reel. But
charming.
And it's fun to see a Lloyd short where it's not all about how much action he can do and all the physical stunting. Just like put him on a train with a little girl and, you know, away they go.
A lot of it's his interplay with the little girl, which is real sweet, I think. It's very funny.
It's very nice, yeah.
And the little girl's very good.
Yeah, she's wonderful.
And she's just adorable.
Yeah, her name was Anna Mae Bilson, and she's in this, and she's in the very first Our Gang comedy called Our Gang. She's the leading lady. And then there's nothing else, and I haven't been able to find any more info about her. So I don't think she was like a professional child actress. She may have been someone that the people at the Roach people knew, you know, because when they started Our Gang, they picked, you know, they went with kids that were family members of people that worked at the studio or people knew children. So she may not have been a professional child actress, but she's very good. She's very self-possessed, and she's, you know,
she's got a nice screen presence as well.
She does.
Yeah.
And this film has a lot, you know, it has the regular people, like Charles Stevenson is the train conductor who Harold has trouble with. William Gillespie is her father. But there are a lot of other people that aren't necessarily regular Roach people, like Anna Mae Bilson. Her mother at the very beginning, the kind of neglectful mother who's throwing the dance party, is Norma Nichols. And she was a comedy ingenue in the teens. She worked at Senate. She appears with Arbuckle in Fatty's Tin Tight Tangle and a couple of things. She ended up supporting Hammond Budd. You know, she was the girl.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, that would be the leading lady for those two scuzzy bums. She did that for a while. And she was actually Hal Roach's sister-in-law. Hal Roach married an actress who worked a lot at Pathé and Balboa, named Marguerite Nichols, and her younger sister was Norma Nichols. They were both doing films. And Norma was in some of the Roach films. She was in the Eddie Boland comedies, where they had the group of women called the Vanity Fair Girls. She was one of them. And then she worked with Larry Seaman in 1921. She was his leading lady in things like The Bellhop and things for a while, and then she retired. And also the sort of mean guy in the bathroom, who gives Harold a hard time. He gave Carter DeHaven a hard time in the film we showed, Wagging Tail.
Oh, his that explains why he looked familiar, yeah.
His name is Charles Force, which I think is a perfect name because he always plays these blustery kind of mean characters. And so he turns up, and one of my favorites actually turns up. The woman in the ladies' room when Harold's trying to motion to the
girl.
Oh,
who is that?
Her name's Vera White. But she's the one who thinks Harold's flirting with her.
Yeah, she's great.
She's so funny.
Yeah, she's very great,
She's almost, starting in 1921, she's practically in every Roach comedy.
That's why she looks familiar to me. Okay.
She always delivers. She always gets her laughs. Probably the biggest role she had at Roach was in the Laurel and Hardy film, We Fall Down. There are these two girls that take Stan and Ollie home because their clothes get wet. And she's one of the two women. But she worked at other studios, too. She's in Dr. Pickle and Mr. Pride. She's a towns lady that Stan surprises by blowing up a paper bag and, you know, popping it. And she's in a Ben Turpin comedy, one of his Weiss brothers' comedies called The Cockeyed Family. And she's Ben's cross-eyed wife. She's more cross-eyed than Ben is. I mean, she's really doing it. She's always funny. And then Earl Mohan was a drunk.
Yeah, well, he's always...
He drinks the milk, you know, and says poison.
Yeah.
But
if for those of you, you know, watching, that if you've seen Safety Last, he's the drunk in Safety Last. Yeah. That's where he typically plays that.
Yeah, it's like the same character, you know, on a train trip.
Yeah,
but and one funny bit is when Harold gets Charles Force's ticket, and it says Elmira, New York on it.
I mentioned this to Mona when we were watching the film earlier.
Yeah, that's
this week.
Hal Roach's hometown.
Right,
that's where he was born. But whenever anybody's going somewhere in a Roach comedy or there's a train depot, it says Elmira, New York. So it's a real in-joke that they used all the time.
Yeah.
Oh, and one other person, too.
Yeah.
The kind of stuffy, matronly lady that Harold has problems with in the birth and then in the ladies' room is her name's Evelyn Burns. And she's in a lot of Roach films. She plays Charlie Chase's mother in Bad Boy, his society mother.
Uh-huh.
And she's in a lot of stuff, too. She's a regular, but she doesn't usually get a lot of attention.
Yeah, so yeah. And one thing I just wanted to give a shout out to Mildred Davis, because that one moment where she gets stuck with the pin,
it's hilarious. Yeah.
Yeah, it's really great. I mean, it's almost like the kind of a face you'd see Lloyd make, and maybe he helped her, but it's a great little moment that she has.
They never have
it's
her
just
do
hers.
That kind of thing.
Right.
Yeah, she never does it, but you know, for me it was a callback to her as a little girl.
Oh, yeah.
Thing with the caterpillar.
Yeah.
It was like that little girl get the same
face, yeah.
It's funny too, because it comes, you know, he says, "I remember your smile." And then she makes that face.
Yeah, that crazy face. It's a great little breakout moment, because as Mana noticed when we were watching the film, that once they get on the train, Mildred kind of disappears until the end of the film. So unless you see a little bit to do there.
One thing I don't understand in the film is why she's spending all that time with William Gillespie, who's playing the little girl's father. I don't understand the plot, why she's not taking care of the little girl.
We couldn't figure that out.
It's a little bit like she didn't kidnap the baby.
No, she's just taking her along.
She just left him with Harold. Maybe she took her without asking, because the little girl wants her to take her along.
Yeah.
So maybe she did, and she's afraid he'll find out.
And maybe there's a part of the film that explains that they edited out so they can get down to three reels. Who knows? Yeah.
That's possible.
But you go, and I just wanted to share this image that you sent me, speaking of Mildred.
Oh, yes.
This is a great behind-the-scenes shot. Where did this turn up?
From Harold's own collection of photographs. So this is something Richard Simonton Jr. had posted online. He has a Harold Lloyd Facebook page. It's like the official Harold Lloyd page. And it's a wonderful, Mildred looks, she's beautiful. And Harold's,
your eyes just go right to her, yeah.
And of course, Harold's mugging with the milk bottle on his head. And that's Roy Brooks
on the left,
sitting next to Mildred, who has some bits. And he was her childhood friend. He came out to California. And then you've got Charles Stevenson and William Gillespie in the background.
Yeah, and Roy Brooks is the rival in Number Please, which we've shown earlier in this
in
the series.
Yeah, he's in High and Dizzy too.
Yeah,
he's in that. He's in Number, and he became Harold's social secretary for years. He lived at Greenacres. He lived on the plot. So
definitely. So let's move on to our Cabin Fever recommendations. Steve, what do you have to recommend for everybody?
Well, this is a little unusual for me, but since it's October and we're getting close to Halloween. This is a book called Hollywood Gothic, The Tangled Tale of Dracula from Novel to Stage to Screen by David J. Skoll. And this was written in 1990, and it's about the writing of the Bram Stoker's novel Dracula, but then how it was adapted to the stage, and then how they made silent films like Nosferatu out of it, and then, of course, the Universal production of Dracula. But he really uncovered all kinds of just fascinating information. And one thing that this book really did was Universal made a Spanish language version of the sound Dracula at the same time that the Lugosi was made. The Lugosi company shot during the day and the Spanish company shot at night on the same sets. And it's a fantastic film, and in many ways it's more cinematic. Yeah. Then the Lugosi film, the camera moves all over the place and you see different angles on those fantastic sets. They built those huge sets.
Yeah.
And they worked out a lot of problems, like where Dracula, instead getting out of his coffin, it's sort of a mist appears and then he materializes out of the coffin. And it was directed by a guy named George Melford, who directed Roscoe Arbuckle in The Roundup and Valentino in The Sheik. So he was a well-known Hollywood director, and the cameraman was a guy named George Robinson, who ended up taking over all the Universal horror films from the mid-30s on. So they really did a great job, but this film wasn't really known, and David Scull really sort of championed it, and then it was restored and released on DVD. It's available. It's really wonderful. The only drawback to the Spanish language is the actor that plays Dracula resembles Edward Everett Horton a little bit. So in some scenes where he sees a cross, he kind of he winces and he looks like Horton. So it's a little bit odd. But the actor that plays Renfield is brilliant.
Yeah.
And what Dwight Fry is brilliant in the American version too.
Yeah.
But it's a great book, and it's, you know, the Spanish language Dracula is really worth taking a look at.
Yeah, great. And what I have to recommend to everybody is a restoration that my friend Eric Grayson did a few years ago of Little Orphaned Annie. There's a T on the end. It's not Gloriaski and Sandy and everything. This is Little Orphaned Annie, which is based on the James Whitcomb Riley poem. If you've ever heard, and if you don't know that name, if you've ever heard the expression, the goblins will get you if you don't watch out, it comes from that, and that's what this story is. And if you recognize that face, that is Colleen Moore.
Yay.
This is her earliest surviving feature film, and it had been around for many years in different forms that were blurry and smeary, and as Eric discovered, were out of order. He got a grant from the National Film Preservation Foundation, raised money and did an amazing job working with at least 5, maybe 6 different prints, putting Humpty Dumpty back together again. So if you've seen the film, or you can find it online, but not as complete as this, I strongly recommend you take a look at it. And I scored it, and I don't remember a lot about the score, except Eric keeps saying it's one of the best things he's ever heard me record. So pick up The Little Orphaned Annie, and probably the easiest way to find it, go to the show page for Silent Comedy Watch Party and follow the link to find it on Amazon. But Little Orphaned Annie, starring Colleen Moore, in restoration. If you want the restoration, you get the Blu-ray disc and the DVD in the same case, so no matter what you have at your house, you're all set. I did want to mention a couple of things I have coming up. These are all live stream shows that I'll be doing that are hosted by other venues. So I'll be doing something called Noxferatu, which is an annual Halloween silent film event held in Knoxville, Tennessee, and hosted by Kelly Robinson. Except this year, they can't do it in person, so I'm helping Kelly, but we're doing a live stream right out of our living room, and Kelly will be in Tennessee, and we'll be showing things like Dr. Pickle and Mr. Pride, Au Secours with Max Linder, and a few other things. On Wednesday the 21st, I'm playing for The Penalty with Lon Chaney. Also, it's a great Lon Chaney film, spooky film, dark and macabre, and that'll be presented by the Cinema Arts Center. And on Saturday, October 24th, I'll be playing for The Mark of Zorro, which is being presented by the AFI Silver Theater. And all of these streams are free or pay what you wish. The links are on our website.
Private screenings, they're not public. So
yes, exactly. You have to sign up. So go find the link on our show page, go to the venue, get yourself a ticket, throw a couple of bucks in their hat if you can, and really help them out. And so those are some shows I have coming up.
Fantastic those shows, though, thanks to you guys,
yeah.
Because if we weren't doing these live stream shows since March, nobody would have heard that you could actually do this.
Yeah, this worked thanks to you and you watching and tuning in. And so it allowed me to say to other venues, you know, I can do this for you guys. So we're able to continue the silent film experience beyond just these funny movies we share with you every Sunday. Before I send you off into the rest of your days, Steve, any closing words from you?
No, not really. I mean, it's, yesterday ended the virtual Port and Enmay Silent Film Festival, which went really well. We had a book event on Monday for the Fatty Arbuckle book that went without a hitch and went very well. And they did well with their virtual. Ben and I are working on a couple of screenings for the Bristol Slapstick Festival.
I think those are going to be
in November, though, I think, right?
Those are going to be in January.
January, oh,
yeah, that's
maybe the deadlines are in November, I'm thinking of. Anyway.
Yeah, so, yeah.
But we're working on those. So there's a lot, you know, going to be happening online. So, you know, for film fans, there'll be a lot to see. So yeah. I just want to thank everyone for tuning in like every week. And I hope everyone stays well and stays safe. And we'll see you next week for Sunshine Sammy, which is very exciting.
Yeah. Yeah. Thanks, Steve. Thank you very much. Thanks.
So long.
Oh. So that's our show. That's episode 29 of the Silent Comedy Watch Party. We're here every week serving up classic silent film comedy laughs to help you get through what you're getting through wherever you are. I'm Ben Modell, here in my apartment with my wife, Mona Allen, and our sleeping dog somewhere.
Well, she woke up in the middle,
in the middle of a Lloyd short. We had to,
I had to bring her back to the bedroom.
And my acoustic piano, we're creating the scores during the show just for you. Steve's in his place, his wife Susan, and we want to thank you, Susan, thank you, Marlene, thank you, Crystal, and thank you for watching, and thanks for sharing the links and helping get the word out so that more and more people can get taken out of whatever they're going through and up into the wonderful, crazy world of silent comedy film. We are set up online if you are so inclined or able to throw a couple of bucks in our hat through Square or PayPal or Venmo or what have you. There's information on how to get that taken care of on Patreon, etc. on the Silent Comedy Watch Party website. It's not why we're here, but if you want to help us out, it's much appreciated. But mostly, we want to thank you for watching. Hope you stay well, stay healthy, stay safe, stay sane, keep laughing. And we will see you again next week at the same time, live right here on YouTube on the Silent Comedy Watch Party.
Have a wonderful week,
everybody. Have a wonderful week. We'll see you next time. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you again next time on the Silent Comedy Watch Party.
See you next Sunday, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye.